Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Year of the Locust, a thriller by Terry Hayes. Read by Jeff Harding.
We have met the enemy, and he is us. Walt Kelly, Earth Day Poster, 1970. The Day After Tomorrow. Part 1. 1. I once went to kill a man. At other times, in younger days, I had followed my work through the neon-lit alleys of Tokyo, watched the sun rise over the Mosque of the Nine Cupolas, and waited on the waterfront in old Istanbul as a woman's tears fell like rain. This time, it was way out east, where the Aegean Sea runs into the Mediterranean and the Turkish sun beats down on a chain of tiny islands. The smallest of them was also the most remote. Waves broke over the wreck of a freighter lying on a reef. Dangerous currents swirled through hidden coves, and a fishing village, its wooden boats long gone, was nothing but ruins now. I landed in late spring, put ashore by the Egyptian skipper of a tramp steamer, who was wise enough not to ask many questions. I can still recall the breeze on my face and the heady scent of pine needles as I moved through a silent forest. As I have done for most of my working life, I stuck close to the shadows. My target that day was a brave man, no doubt of it, supposedly a German out of Nuremberg, that beautiful old city steeped in so much dark history. And when I surprised him in the kitchen of his lonely villa, we both knew I had traveled a long distance, both in miles and in years, to arrive at such a deadly rendezvous. I was a member of the agency back then, and for many years had gone under the code name Kane. 5 years earlier, the German had been a trusted asset of U.S. intelligence in Tehran. What nobody knew, but found out soon enough, was that he was secretly working as a contractor for the Russians. It seems like everything is being outsourced these days, even espionage. On a quiet Monday night, he had gone for a late meal in the bistro at Tehran's Gilded Espinas Palace Hotel, and in the men's room had delivered the names of 10 of our most valuable Iranian sources to a representative of Moscow Central. It is well known in the secret world that the spy agencies of Russia and Iran have worked hand in glove for years, so it was inevitable that the list of names would end up with Pava, the brutal Iranian secret police. As a result, our network, built over many years at a huge cost in lives and treasure, and more importantly, a vital backdoor into the Iranian nuclear program, was destroyed within hours. Even for the CIA, an organization that had known its fair share of failure, it ranked as an unqualified disaster. The consequences for the 8 men and 2 women who were unmasked as a result of our assets' betrayal were far more catastrophic. They appeared before a judge in a late-night trial, and the next day workmen started to assemble 10 towering construction cranes in one of Tehran's largest squares. While members of the public didn't pay much attention at first, their purpose soon became clear. It was to ensure that as many people as possible could witness the court's sentence being carried out. In many countries in the Middle East, it is not enough that people are punished. Everybody else must be warned. Once the towers had been erected, the horizontal arms were attached. Coils of rope were fixed to the end of the jibs, and late on a spring day, 4 black prison vans brought the captives to the square. One by one, as the minutes crawled by, each of them was conveyed in a cage to the top of their own personal crane. There, under the gaze of the crowd gathered below, revolutionary guards forced the terrified men and women onto a small platform at the end of each jib. They hung a sign on each prisoner's chest, identifying them as a spy for the Great Satan, and a noose, popularly known in the country as the Iranian necktie, was then dropped over their head. Thanks to the careful planning, people packed in the square were all afforded an unimpeded view of the 10 figures above them. Against a clear blue sky, they seemed to be suspended between heaven and earth. Given the circumstances, I suppose that was exactly where they were. A small huddle of men and women closest to the cranes, most likely relatives and friends, were on their knees, wailing and praying. They looked up as a uniformed man, a lieutenant colonel, climbed on top of one of the vans and spoke in Farsi through a loudhailer, his voice echoing across the square. He read out the name of each prisoner, the charge, and then the sentence. Finally, he lowered the pieces of paper and, more loudly, said a word which translated as ready. One of the condemned prisoners, a man, heard the word, and his courage failed. He screamed, calling on God to save him. As usual, at least in my experience, such a plea had no apparent effect. In a well-practiced routine, the Revolutionary Guard stepped forward and each placed their right hand on the small of a prisoner's back. At this gesture, a heavy silence fell across the crowd, and a child, a boy, aged about 6, stood up from among the group of friends and relatives and stared up at one of the prisoners, possibly a mother or father, and started calling out a name. A woman beside him pulled him back down. The boy started to cry, and after what seemed like an eternity, the man with the loud hailer gave the next order. Now. The guards, in unison, pushed the prisoners forward. 10 pairs of feet left the wooden platforms, and an involuntary gasp went up from the crowd. The relatives and friends watched shoes and sandals rain down as the victims fell through the air. Plunging feet first towards the square far below, the coils of rope reeled out fast behind them. When the coils ran out, the rope snapped hard against their anchors. The nooses tightened around 10 throats, the prisoners jerked upwards, and their necks snapped in an instant. Nobody in the crowd said a word. The only sound was the wailing of the families as the 10 bodies swung gently in the warm Middle Eastern breeze. I wasn't surprised that the crowd had reacted with silence. It has been my misfortune to witness a number of executions, several by firing squad, 2 by hanging, and 1 when an elderly man had been strapped into an electric chair and forced to ride the lightning, as the guards on death row call it. And I can promise you, the terror on the face of a man or woman as everything they had hoped to be vanishes into eternity never leaves you. The memory of it will surface at 3 a.m., when everything you fear most in the world is on its way, coming up the stairs to find you. Several days earlier, in the Espinas men's room, the German, in payment for the list of names, had received an attaché case containing a fortune in anonymous Swiss bearer bonds. I'm not a believer. Nobody could ever say that about me. But 2,000 years ago, St. Paul wrote something that, once heard, is not easily forgotten. The love of money is the root of all evil. It certainly was that night in Tehran. From the moment the traitor had left his coffee cup, an old raincoat, 2 cigarette butts, and a crumpled credit card receipt on the table in the bistro, entered the bathroom, made the exchange, exited via an adjoining cigar bar, swung onto the back of a waiting motorcycle taxi, and vanished into the city, the agency's analysts estimated that 92 seconds had elapsed. 92 seconds to turn yourself into a multimillionaire, destroy an entire intelligence network, and sign the death warrants of 10 colleagues. By any measure, he was a very good spy. As a self-taught freelancer, he was out of the box. As you would expect, the CIA, the deeply flawed but occasionally brilliant organization where I had worked for the previous 12 years, made numerous attempts to find him. But none of them came close to success, and with more evidence of his double dealing surfacing daily, his status grew until he became something of a dark legend to U.S. intelligence. Worse still, the agency's analysts drilled down and found that over the years he had assumed so many fake identities that the company was finally forced to admit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.